Thank you. What's up, everybody? Hey, sorry I took so long. I don't really have a good reason. Hello, nice to see you. Welcome back to another Tuesday Studio Hours live stream. So this is definitely a lot more chill than the typical high energy Friday stream. Because I just work on stuff and we just talk, but it's pretty good. I've come to appreciate it quite a bit. Thank you to anyone who was bearing with me on that exceptionally long starting soon screen. Of course, as soon as I did it, something occurred in the home and I was like, really? Right. I literally just pressed starting. Okay, whatever. So hello. Nice to see you guys. Before we do anything today, before we say anything, I gotta do the thing. Exclamation point book. There's still a Kickstarter campaign for my art book, The Doodle Book, Volume 1. We are officially fully funded, which is absolutely incredible. So thank you. If you're watching this and you are one of the people that backed it, I really appreciate that. Thank you very, very much for supporting me and supporting this project. It means a lot. Also, if you just shared it, if you shared it on social media, I really appreciate that. There is still, of course, still time to do that. So if you can't back the project financially, if you can share it through word of mouth, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, all those things, I would really appreciate it. And of course, I've been posting ad nauseum about it every day because that's what you're supposed to do. So if it's easier just to reshare, retweet, or repost something I've already done, you're certainly welcome to do that. Maybe I should actually look before I say this. We are officially funded, which means that it's gonna happen. So that is no longer a concern. We don't need to worry about the book not happening. It is happening. I just wanna tell you what we are at. So I need to log in to do that. See, these are kind of the little things that I do before I go live when I'm working behind the starting soon screen, and I can't do that when something goes chaos as soon as I do that. Oh my goodness, why is it slugging along to log into Kickstarter? Okay, it doesn't matter. So yeah, we are fully funded. I believe we're 103%, which is awesome, but definitely still time if you'd like to join and guarantee yourself a copy of the book. I'm not using Kickstarter as like a pre-sale thing. Unfortunately, I'm just not financially in a position to do that. So it's like an all or nothing. And I'm happy to say we are funded, so it is happening. But I'm not planning on ordering a substantial additional amount of these books to have. So if you really want one, this is the way to do it. Make sure you back the project because you will guarantee yourself a copy of the book. So yeah, wanted to get that out of the way. So we have a lot of stuff to talk about, guys. We have a lot of things to talk about. I have a lot of artwork to show. Because last week, I tried to do this stream on Tuesday, and then my internet fell apart. Well, I should say my modem fell apart. The modem decided it didn't want to work anymore. So I could not maintain a stable internet connection. There was internet, but it was not stable, so it kept rebooting and it kept kicking me off. So we didn't get to talk at all about Fan Expo Boston, which I'd like to do, because I had a lot of fun when we did like a debrief from Kineticon, which was the event prior to that. So let's do that. I'm gonna open some photographs, and you guys are absolutely welcome to ask questions about anything, as always. Fan Expo Boston, here we go. So, Fan Expo Boston 2022 in Boston, Massachusetts. Surprise, who would have thought? This is a photograph of my booth, my table slash booth at the show. This is my second time to be at Fan Expo Boston. I do like it, I think it's a great show. I think it's a great show. It is definitely sizable. It is a sizable event. It's got some pretty awesome guests each year. But of course, you know, Fan Expo is a multi $100 million/billion industry. You know, right up there with the likes of like Reed Pop. So these are heavy hitter, businessy shows, which I think hurts and also helps. So, you know, pros and cons with everything, but I definitely think, you know, there's some good stuff about it. I keep going back to it. The funny thing is it funny? Is it ironic? Is it sad? I don't know. This is a corner table. So, I guess because this, let me use my classic, I'm going to draw on this to help explain what I'm saying. I don't want to have a face cam. I'm like, have no interest in having a face cam, for the record, for like ever. So, this, right? This. See this? See this? See this? See this? I guess that makes this a corner. I don't know. I'm not sold on that. Let me show you guys a picture from AwesomeCon. I don't have that on this computer. Okay. That's all right. So at AwesomeCon, which was in Washington, D.C., I had a corner table, and it was like two tables coming together to form a corner. And so I booked a, quote, corner table at Fan Expo Boston, and this is what I got. I don't believe this is a corner by my definition, and by other shows' definitions, I don't believe this is a corner. I think it's kind of a scam to get more money out of artists. So you see this walkway, like, is not very wide. Like, honestly, the edge of it is kind of like right here, because it's like a, it's not a main walkway. Right, it's not a main, it's like a it's like a man-made extra small aisle. What's up, Jeff? Kevin, is that your corner that you yeah, that's my corner. This is my corner right here. See the corner? So I was not pleased with that, because yeah, I went into this show very much thinking, and I paid $100 extra for that corner table. The standard artist table, $295. And then the corner table was $375. I believe that's what it was. So I paid a lot of extra money to have a corner table, and I didn't get that. I was not the only one. There were probably 100 artists. Hey, thanks, Jeff. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. Subscribe in 8 months. Jeff says, we're about to have a baby. Is that real, Jeff? Is that a real thing, or you... Is that a joke? I mean, it's a pretty serious thing to joke about, but that's pretty incredible, man. Oh, 9 months up. That is not the same as giving birth to a human being. I appreciate it, Jeff. Thank you. Trekkie Intermom is here. Yo, what's up? Hey, hello. And Euro Gamer Girl... That's like side street or alley. That is not worth the extra you pay. I know it's not. It's a scam. But like I said, tons of other artists also went in on this, and everybody was equally as mad. We were mad enough that the Fan Expo management brought us all complimentary donuts and coffee on Sunday, because they were like, oh, we just want to make sure you guys feel appreciated. It's like, okay. But yeah, I mean, I had a specific plan, right? I had a specific plan to use both tables at a corner, and I didn't get a corner. So that's a thing. That happened. I do not... Okay, if you're an artist and you are going to be at Fan Expo Boston, it is a good show, okay? It is a good show. It's got good foot traffic. I enjoy it. Do not pay for the corner table, okay? Standard artist table is fine, and I rebooked already because they do offer a discount the weekend of. If you do it on site, you can get a discount. It's like $30, but you know, it adds up. I did not rebook the corner table. I rebooked the standard artist table. But yeah, this show has the standard artist table $295, the corner table $375, and then the premium end cap, which was like 8 something, like 825 maybe. And the premium is where they give you straight up 2 tables. You can't see that. 2 tables side by side. And you're on the end. I'm not making that much money. I'm not making that much money to be swinging in with the premium. Eurogamer Girl says, donuts and coffee. What a joke. I know, right? I didn't even bother. I was like, I will not partake in this confection. Slap the cup out of their hand. Glad it was still a good show. It was still a good show. But that's like, you know, hey, it's a lesson. So I don't recommend doing that. So yeah, if you're an artist and you want to go to that show, don't do the corner. The corner table's a scam. Standard artist table's fine. Or if you have enough content, like if you have enough prints and stuff, you can definitely do the premium end cap. I mean, it's worth it if you have enough stuff to put there, but I don't. So I did not opt for that. So this is my setup. It hasn't changed a great deal over the last few shows, so there's not any new prints. This was kind of shocking. Let me show you this. I'll admit, I was a little surprised, okay? I don't want to be too full of myself, but I was a little surprised. I drew Obi-Wan. This is on a blank Star Wars comic. So a blank cover. So there's the full comic, and then there's a blank cover, and then, you know, the point is that artists draw something on the cover. This is a Star Wars issue 1 from Marvel 2014, I think, 2015. Obviously I've had it for a while. I forgot about it. A former colleague of mine gave me this. Oh my goodness. Years and years and years ago, and was like, hey, you're an artist. I thought you might appreciate this. And at the time, I mean, I wasn't drawing anything at the time. Anything. I wasn't even picking up a pencil. Because I was too deeply engrossed in the corporate marketing culture. It's the dark times. Talk about the dark time where I didn't draw at all for years and years and years. So I didn't have anything to do with it. I mean, obviously it was cool, but I was like, all right, I didn't know what to do with it. So it just vanished into my bookcase. And it wasn't until I went through all my stuff for a big yard sale earlier in the summer when I stumbled across it. I said, oh my goodness. And now I'm very much doing this. This is absolutely what I'm doing every day. And I'm like, I forgot I had this. So I was flipping back and forth between whether or not I wanted to draw Vader on this or Obi-Wan. And I thought, it was really hard. I was like, at the last second, I was still going back and forth between Vader and Obi-Wan. But I went with Obi-Wan. I've drawn Vader a couple times. Doesn't mean I'm not opposed to drawing him again. But I definitely have not drawn Obi-Wan much at all. This might be the only time I've drawn Obi-Wan. So, this is obviously from the streaming series. Ewan McGregor, my stylized version of him. Eurogamer Girl says, that's cool. Obi-Wan looks cool. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. So I drew this while I was at Kineticon. So that's a show in Hartford, and that was 3 weeks ago. And it didn't sell, and that's okay. If I don't have any commissions at the show, if I don't have any conversations I'm having, I try to draw something, if nothing else, just to get people to walk over to the table and engage with me in a conversation. And he didn't sell, so that's okay. But Ewan McGregor was a headlining celebrity at Fan Expo Boston. And so I'm like, I was confident that if it hadn't sold at Kineticon, it would probably sell at Fan Expo Boston because the actor was there. I was incorrect in that assumption. The Obi-Wan has still not sold. You can see there's a fancy little sign too. I thought, hey, maybe they could buy it. Maybe they could go get it autographed, buy the celebrity while they're here. That didn't work. So I still have Obi-Wan. It is for sale on my shop if you want to buy it. So !shop in the chat. Gives you a link to my store. I do have all my stuffs online. So all my stickers, all my prints, all my originals are there. And I dropped Obi-Wan. I dropped it $10. I had it listed for $60, I dropped it down to 50 just because now it's been a couple shows he hasn't sold, and I feel like with it not selling when Ewan McGregor's there, I feel like that's probably a big miss. So it's like, all right, I can justify dropping the price now on this. So that was interesting. But yeah, nothing else was new. It's the same stuff. Was there anything new for this show? No, all these prints I had for sale at the last show, and then for the stickers, I had a couple new doodle stickers. Do I have a photograph of that to show you? Of the new one? I don't think I do. But yeah, it doesn't matter. So, yes, Fan Expo Boston. Let me tell you guys, let me share some of the data. I like sharing the data with you guys because why not? Because I am very much interested in helping all my fellow artists in making this work, and it's not easy. It's very difficult to make a living off of being an artist. You could say it's a lot of hard work.
Well, art is not all fun and games. It's a lot of hard work.
That's right, Squidward. So, let's see. Fan Expo Boston. I did hit my goal. So my goal was to make over $1,000. That was my goal. My goal was to make over $1,000 during the duration of the 3-day event. And yes, I did that. So goal was accomplished. I didn't break any records. It was not my highest grossing show for the year. There's still plenty of shows left to do, but it was good. I hit the goal. Yes, yay for meeting your goal. Indeed, yes. So what was the best-selling sticker? The best-selling sticker I had was Al. It was Al Elric from Full Metal Alchemist. Can you see that on this? I don't think so. Do I have a photograph? So still a lot of my files are in between the two computers, the old one and the new one. So sometimes I don't have photographs of the older stuff. Let me open up my shop, because I realize that we get new people every day, and so not everyone knows all the stuff I've done. So let me grab a picture for you guys to see. And as always, I appreciate you guys being here and spending your time with me. You could be anywhere. You could be doing anything. I could be doing anything. We're here. Together. That's right. I'll do a print screen. Let's see. All right. There you go. So this is the sticker of Al Elric from the anime Full Metal Alchemist. That was my top-selling sticker from Fan Expo Boston. And it really does change every time. It really does. There's not a heck of a lot of consistency from show to show to show. Something can sell super well at one show, and then it'd be a total dud at the next show. So the show before this, again, was Kineticon in Hartford, Cuphead. Cuphead was the top-selling sticker for that show by far. And at Boston, I sold 0 Cupheads. So in the span of 2 weeks, Cuphead went from being top seller to no seller. So but for Boston, Al Elric was the number one. He was the top-selling sticker. And then for the prints, nothing really stood out for the prints. It was all onesies and twosies of everything. So, you know, Ahsoka, Batman, Joker, Demon Slayer, Five Nights at Freddy's, Sam, Trick or Treat. It was just kind of the same. Everything was just onesie-twosie, so nothing stood out. For the small prints, what's up, John Y? Will your platinum patrons get a copy of the Doodle Book? Yes, they will. Yes, they will indeed. And thank you for asking, and nice to see you. Welcome to the stream. So, exclamation point, Patreon. I do have a Patreon. I take very good care of my patrons because my patrons take very good care of me. And my platinum tier patrons, which is the highest, most generous tier I have, that is $50 a month. I realize that is a lot of money. I'm totally, totally aware.
Nearby the castle.
The joy. The joyfulness is over. I wish that was louder. I can't make it louder. But the platinum tier patrons actually get one of every single thing I make and sell. So they get every sticker, they get every print, they get every book. And books have been new. Books are new to this year, all right? So there's the Pro Gamer's Guide, there's Grasslands, and now there's the Doodle Book. And that was kind of not even a thing when I was planning out the Platinum or any of the Patreon refresh last November. So, but I am definitely planning to make sure each of the Platinum get one as well. So you don't have to hop onto the Kickstarter if you don't want to, because you will have one. So it's only if you wanted to have an extra one for any reason. But yes, Platinum tier patrons do get a complimentary copy of the book. Well, I know it's not complimentary because you give me money every month, but you will get one as well. But yeah, I haven't super been like overly open about that, just because, yeah, it wasn't really a thing before, but now it is a thing because apparently books are a thing. What was I going to show you guys? Oh, let me go back to my website here. Hang on, bear with me a minute. So, you know what? No, it's probably in here actually. So I was going to show you, I've decided to retire most of my small prints. So small prints are the half sheet of paper. It's like 8.5 by 5.5. And there's a couple designs that are finally gone. All right, so here's one. I'm going to show this. So this is the Joker, or just Joker, right? He's just Joker in the Joaquin Phoenix film, which was absolutely mind-blowing. So this was a small print that I had for sale for a long time, and this was a slow burn. This one was definitely a slow burn. I like the style on it, but you know, I know that not everybody jives with everyone's style. Obviously, it was a little bit taller for the ratio of the paper. I just cropped this for the website, so that you can see a little bit more of the face on the wall and a little bit more of the brick. This is gone. So I sold the last one of this small print at Fan Expo Boston. They are gone. They are done. None on the website, none here at my house. They are gone forever. So that print is finished. And then I've got one more small print that is also retired, and I've only got like two or three left, and then they are also done. They're done, not coming back. Let me share this one with you guys. I really need to transfer all my files back over, because then it'll be a lot easier. I won't have to do this. I won't have to do this action. I'm usually good with all the new stuff. It's just anything prior to a couple months ago is all on the old computer. All right, there you go. So this is the Aztec Medusa. So this one was not originally intended to be a print at all. This was actually a design for a tattoo. So it was just black and white, and I was like, oh, you know, I kind of like that, so let's color it. And then after I colored it, I was like, oh, maybe someone would like this as a print. So I did a very small run of prints of these. It was like 25. And again, it's cool. People point at it. They like to say, you know, positive things, but, oh, it's really neat. It's cool. But it's another slow burn. It's been sitting on the table for, you know, more than a year with just the 25 or whatever I had. But they're finally going. There's like two or three left, as I said, and then they are gone. They are done forever. So let's see, Fan Expo Boston, anything else? So I want to show you guys some of the artwork that I did at Fan Expo Boston. So let me show you that. So, was the first one? The first thing I did have a commission on Friday, which was wonderful. Commissions are super helpful. Super helpful. Commissions is where the money's at for me. So obviously, I sell a lot of stickers, and the stickers are at the price point of like $2 or $5. And then I've got the prints, which are $15 or the 2 for $20. So it's like the commissions is where like those are the big ticket items. I do them right at the show. They're traditional, so I will, depending on how polished the client wants, I do offer pencil sketch commissions, I offer cleaned up polished line art commissions, and then full rendered colored pieces. So, and then obviously I also break it down by bust, so it's like shoulder up, half body, or full body. And the price is factored into all of that. So this is a full body, full render colored commission. So this is an $80 commission. So this was on Friday. This is a somewhat obscure Star Wars character. She was a senator in one of the Clone Wars episodes. I believe Senator Chuchi is her name. I think she's on a snow planet, if I recall correctly. So I was asked to, I was commissioned to draw that on Friday, and that was pretty awesome. Never mind. I was just about to say something, but that's not correct. I do have a photograph of the client holding it. I do ask for permission from the client. I said, do you mind if I grab a photo of you holding the commission, and do you mind if I share it online? And they most of the time say yes. Not had someone say no yet. So this was the guy that commissioned that. He was very happy with it. And yeah, it was really nice. It was a nice way to start the show. Friday having a $80 commission was incredible. I was hoping for a lot of commissions at this show. I didn't get a lot. I got two. But this is one of two. All right. So since I said there was two, there was another. So I had another commission. So my buddy Brian was there. And Brian does live streaming, and Brian does his whole universe of things. And he was there. He was an integral part of our corner strategy that did not pan out well. But Brian has his own branding. You know, we work together on the children's book, The Pro Gamer's Guide, and he's usually pretty generous in commissioning me if we're together at a show at some point. I certainly don't force his hand. I think he's got a ton of ideas just locked and loaded, ready to go if the mood hits or if the timing. So he wanted this one, and he wanted me to keep it secret until he showed it, and he did show it on his live stream last night. So that means it is out there in the internet now. So this was his commission. And you know what's funny? I didn't think about this until afterwards. Is I always ask, right? I ask the commissioners, hey, can I grab a photo of you holding this for social media? I did not ask him to do that. Which was just like, I totally spaced asking for that. I think it's because, you know, we're friends, we see each other all the time, so it didn't cross my mind. So I have no photograph of him holding it, but here you go. So this is his cartoon self on the left, wearing an inflatable penguin suit, being taught how to walk. Hey, look, speaking of that, there's the, you can see the book cover in the upper left-hand corner on the portfolio scroll, or portfolio, what is it, carousel. And then that penguin character is named Cuddles, and so Cuddles is teaching Brian how to penguin waddle. So that was a fun one, and I did that on Sunday, I think? So, that was the second. So those were the two commissions that I got. As I just mentioned with Obi-Wan, if I have no commissions or if I'm not having any conversations with people, I do like to draw something. So I did draw everybody's breakout star from Stranger Things Season 4, Eddie Munson. So Eddie Munson had to happen. I can't tell you how many Eddie Munson cosplays I have seen in the last like three or four shows. It is insane. It is insane, the number of Eddie Munson cosplay. It is insane. So I'm like, hey, you know what? I feel like maybe this is a good move to draw up an Eddie. So, I have another guy. I just remembered I had another commission. Oh, man, I totally spaced. Boba Laveau's going to be mad at me. So Eddie Munson, I drew this just at the table just because I wanted something to do. So I was pretty happy with this. I ended up putting it on the table. I threw a price tag of $40, I think. So usually when I'm putting stuff like this that I just kind of draw, you know, quote unquote for fun, but to, you know, spend time, I don't charge as much as I charge for commissions because like nobody asked for this. So it's like, you know, I kind of temper that a little bit down. If this was a commission somebody wanted, like if they purposefully asked for this and paid for it, this is a full color, full render, half body. So this is a $70 commission. But I just did it because I did it. And so, yeah, I think I asked 40 for it. And it did sell. It sold on Sunday. So that was awesome. So it's got a new home. Eddie didn't run away. So there was one more commission that I totally forgot about it. And the reason I forgot about it is because Boba Laveau, one of my awesome patrons, he reached out to me ahead of time and he asked, hey, can I give you a commission now to do at the show? Which is fine, you can. This is one of the secrets. This is one of the workaround secrets to the Hinkle strategy. Commissions are officially technically closed, right? I'm not taking commissions because I'm just super busy. But that is with the understanding that you want a digital commission, which is what most people want. They want a digital commission. So I take my time, I work on it, you know, at home. And they want it for whatever reason, and that's totally understandable. So that, I have a queue. The queue's been locked for probably about a year now. I don't want to add any more names to it because it's already overwhelming and I got a lot of stuff to go through. But I take commissions at the shows and I do them right then and there, but they're traditional. So these are hand-drawn, colored, inked commissions, which not as many people want. It doesn't mean I try less on it or I put less effort into it, but it's just, it's a different parallel path of getting something drawn by me. And a lot of times it shows, you know, a whole day will go by and I have no commissions. So like I'm either drawing something just cause I want to sell it, or I'm going to work on, or I can potentially work on something like this. So he wanted Ghost Rider 1 million BC, which is a character I had never heard of, but is real from the Marvel comic universe. Where it's a caveman Ghost Rider riding on a woolly mammoth on fire. So he was obviously not at the show. This is something he paid for ahead of time with the understanding that I would work on this at the show as a traditional commission and I would mail it to him after the fact. So it's also a little bit different because it's like two characters, but like animals are always weird because it's like, how do they fit into like my price chart for like a head versus that, like it's an animal. So I agreed to $100 for this. So I said $100 for this because it's a little, you know, it doesn't quite conform to the mold, but I was pretty happy with it. So this one was drawn at the show, but it was not from somebody at the show. But that is an option. So if you're watching, if you're listening after the fact and you would like a traditional commission and you're not too concerned with it being digital, you can potentially reach out to me and set up something like this. And I do shows all the time. This year alone, I've got like 28 shows on the calendar. So I've got lots of opportunities to do traditional commissions. So keep that in mind if that's something you might be interested in. And you know, we've got some really awesome cameras and scanning technology, so you can scan it and it'd be just as good. Eurogamer Girl says, that's awesome, but so unreal. It is unreal. Brix O'Brien is here. What's up? We just looked at your commission. Since the internet already knows now it is no longer a secret. Ghost Rider, Eddie, Brian Waddling, and Chuchi. So that's the artwork drawn at Fan Expo Boston. That's all I have to show from that show. But let me know if you have any questions about Fan Expo Boston, if you want to talk about anything about the show, I'm more than happy to address that. Like I said, overall, it was good. Don't recommend buying the corner table. Just go with the standard, or if you have enough stuff to fill the premium, I think it's worth it if you can fill it. I think you need to be really concentrated and have a robust portfolio to fill up a premium spot. I will be there again. I'll be there in 2023. I've already rebooked at the standard artist table, which is fine. But it was a good show. I did hit my goal. I was happy. And shout out to my buddy Helk Pixel. He's also a streamer here. He does pixel art. We shared an Airbnb, and that was really awesome. Kind of help keep the cost down. And that's another thing. If you're going to these shows, if you can get some other friends to room share with you, man, it makes such a difference. It really does. It makes a huge difference on the wallet. It makes a difference on just like the enjoyability of just going and doing this all the time. So if you can do that, I recommend. All right, that's done. Fan Expo Boston's done. Do we talk about Earthbound or do we talk about Halloween? Because we're going to have to talk about both. I think we should talk about Halloween next. Okay, that's what we should talk about. So every year, Brian's like, I want to talk about Earthbound. I want to end with Earthbound. We're going to end with Earthbound because that's so important to me. So Halloween is here. Did you not know? Halloween's here. Halloween is like today. Halloween's tomorrow. Eurogamer Girl wants Halloween. So every year I release some Halloween stickers. They perform very well. It starts in July. Yes, true. They perform very, very well. People like them. And so I keep the tradition going. So I've started working on my Halloween stuff. Let me turn off some of these other layers here and show you the plan. This is the plan. So these are stickers. These are like 3.5 by 3.5 inches. Probably a little less than that, maybe 3.25. They're big boys. These are the bigger stickers that I sell. I call them portrait stickers. And this is the current plan. So these are just rough concept sketches on how I want it to look, what I want for the layout. What's up, Ray? Funny Figs is here. Hello, Ray. And you'll notice I'm going light. I'm going pretty light this year.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Ray. This has been an insane year. Like an overwhelmingly, insanely busy year. And Halloween is super important. I know I've got folks that are chomping at the bit. And they're all about this. And I want to cater to that. But I'm just so busy. Last year, I released 12 Halloween stickers. So this year, I've scaled back quite a bit. And you'll also see that there's not as many, like, kind of horror movie icons, which is, you know, I'm definitely not getting away from that, but I wanted to, like, add a little bit more of the more lighter spirited, right? Some more of the whimsical Halloween stuff, too. Because I want to have, like, a nice, wide assortment for folks. So this is currently the only plan for Halloween stickers. Maybe a miracle will happen and I'll have more time and I'll do more, but probably not. What's shaken? So, Ray, we just wrapped up talking about Fan Expo Boston. So I went into a debrief and I showed off all the artwork. And now we're talking about Halloween. Eurogamer Girls is awesome. I love the pumpkin and Nightmare Before Christmas. Thank you. So yeah, this is the concept sketch for the pumpkin, the jack-o'-lantern. Dang, I'll have to catch it. Yeah, for sure. For sure, Ray. I go into all the details. I did finish yesterday the final pumpkin. So here's the final artwork for the pumpkin sticker. That is done. I do not think I will redraw that. Heard you were blowing up on TikTok. Yeah, we will talk about that in a moment, Ray. We will discuss that momentarily. Looks great. Thank you. I'm very happy with it. I like the shine, the pumpkin shine on that. And yeah, I think I'll keep the glow. Wait, where is it? Here. Just because I think it adds a little bit more to, you know, getting a candle in there. But it's a separate layer if I don't, you know, if I decide I don't like it. So that's done. The pumpkin is done. I did that yesterday. Jaws. This one, so my Jaws plan to have a sticker for Jaws was in like wave one. I'm talking, you know, 2-3 years ago now at this point when I did my first Halloween wave, I wanted to do a Jaws sticker. And I was like, I just don't know how to do this and not make it look dumb. I was like, how do I do this and not make it look stupid? What's up, Gizmo non-binary? Pumpkin looks cool. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. So I said, you know what? We gotta get Jaws in here. Has to happen. So Jaws is what I was working on next last night. I got the water on a separate layer. So this is kind of, I don't know if I'll do that buoy. I don't think I will. That red buoy is from like the opening scene of Jaws when the lady goes swimming and she vanishes. And I was like, eh. Just because I wanted something to kind of flesh out the design. But I think I'm just going to stick with shark and water, right? Yeah, it looks better with that. I think so, too. I think this is the winner. And I added the fins because I think you need something, right? You need, like, just a little bit more than just the mouth. Yeah, better off. Yeah, I agree. So this is going to be the project for later today. I'm going to work on this Jaws sticker. And then I'll just leave that on there. So then we've got Sam from Trick or Treat. He is a breakout star. This guy. Let me tell you about Sam. Sam like is the level of popularity this character has is unparalleled. So Sam will be the first character that I will have a doodle sticker for, a portrait sticker for, a large print for, and I've already done a original drawing of him. He has crossed the entire spectrum of Hinkle assortment. He's the only character to have done that. He is insanely popular. So I'm gonna do a sticker for him. I'm not gonna do him with like the ripped. So like on my print. Let me show you the print, in case you guys haven't seen the print. Small art print. No, large art print. This is the print. Racist, are you sure that won't cannibalize your own set? I mean, maybe. I don't know. I feel like... So, again, you know... You know, Ray, I'm not an expert in this. I'm just trying everything and seeing what works and what doesn't. I'm hoping that when you're in, right? And you're like, give me all of it. There's been a few folks that have bought the print. And I'm like, oh, I have a little sticker of him too. Because I have the little 2-inch doodle sticker of Sam. They're like, oh, give me that too. Like, usually they're like passionate enough that they just want anything that has to do with him. There might be a couple people that decide not to get the print and get the sticker, I guess. But... I don't know. I feel like it maybe is like a couple different crowds. I really don't know. We'll see. I think he is popular enough that he should be in there. I feel like sometimes people either get the stickers or they get the prints. Like the big stickers, not the little stickers. They usually get the prints or the stickers. They don't usually get both. And so if they're already getting stickers and they usually do the buy five, right, and they're picking out designs, I don't think it'll hurt to have him over there. Oh, well, that changes things. Eurogamer Girl says, many fans want everything for a character, so it should be success. That's my hope. And yeah, that is an upsell potential for sure. So yeah, this is the print. This is the big 11 by 17 print, which has been crazy popular this year. It's brand new. I just did it a couple months ago with the plans for this to be for Halloween, because I knew things were going to get really busy. So But yeah, so that'll be up to it. As you saw, the print has him with like his half mask ripped where you can see his real face. This one will not. This will just be like regular happy-go-lucky Sam. All right, this one should be fun. Yeah, see you later, Eurogamer girl. Thanks for being here. I appreciate it. Have a good rest of your day. So, Adam's Family. I love Adam's Family. Classic Adam's Family, right? I didn't see the cartoon or multiple cartoons. I'm not really interested in seeing the new Wednesday series from Tim Burton. It looks too much. It's too much. I want like my campy Adam's Family where like everything's implied, but you know, like actual blood and gore. And stuff. I'm like, it's too much. For me, it's too much. So I'm not really interested in that. But Gomez and Morticia, right? There's a lot of love for those two characters because obviously there's a lot of love for each other. And this is going to be the first sticker with those two characters because I couldn't separate them. I can't separate them. I can't do it. And I feel like that adds to the bit, is like that they come together. The size, I'm not necessarily planning for this to be like substantially larger than the normal size. It will be a little bit wider because
that belongs in a museum.
Thank you, Ray. It has to be a little wider because it has the two people, but so there'll be a little less profit on this design because it'll cost me a little bit more, but that's okay. There's plenty of others that are, you know, they make up the balance. So Morticia and Gomez together with the house, like a silhouette of the house in the back. I was starting to play around with that last night. Some of like the first sketches, that's not there yet. So I need to play around with it. But I was beginning that process. And then we've got, let me turn off Jaws. We've got Nightmare Before Christmas. So we've got Jack Skellington and Sally. These are separate. These will be two different ones. But I want to make sure that the backgrounds can work if they're side by side. So that there is kind of a collectability mentality to it, I guess, if you want to say it like that. So there'll be like a swarm, a wave of bats that you'll see kind of doing one pattern across. And then I might do a little bit more with the background. So there's a moon, right? There's a moon behind them. And then like a little bit more maybe with the back. I want them to line up. So they're circular, right? So they're not going to touch each other. But I want the backgrounds to line up. I'm also still not 100% sold if I want that to be the expression of Jack. Because, you know, it's either like scary Jack or like, you know, the happy Jack, right? It's like one of the two. I think if I want to keep playing into the working together, I think I want like the happy Jack, you know, and she will definitely be looking towards him. So she's not going to be looking forward. Even if you got it solo, right? Like just the sticker by itself, she's going to be looking that way. Yeah. Happy makes more sense. Yep. I think that's where I'm leaning. But that's all right. That's what all this concept sketching is for. You got to get it out of your head and get it onto the canvas so you kind of know what you're doing. So this is the...
I think I've improved on your methods a bit, too. I employed some chiaroscuro shading.
I'll improve on your methods.
What?
Thank you, Ray. Ray's always here to improve on my methods. He takes a metaphorical lighter out every time he comes by and just drops it on the table. So this is currently... Currently, this is the whole plan for the Halloween wave of stickers because Sam was the print. And I get that I did that a couple months ago, but that was the implied Halloween print for the year. So these stickers, Sam's already done and out. But there's one more element. There's one more element to Halloween that we do here in Hinkle World. And that is a new icon. So if you remember last year, I became a zombie. I think I still have the emote. Right? Or did I get rid of the, I think I got rid of the animated one. But here's Zombie Hink. That's Zombie Hink from last year. Are you guys ready to see the icon for this year? I'm showing you now. You guys here, you guys that watch me here on Twitch, you are so appreciated. I give you exclusive peeks at things. Don't worry, the patrons get to see this stuff too. The patrons absolutely get to see this stuff too. But because you're watching me live and spending time with me, I want to make sure you also get to see some cool things. So, this year, 2022, so starting October 1st, all the branding will switch to Skelly Hink. Skelly Hink. I shall wait for the applause. Looks, it's more skeletons.
It's probably the best drawing I've ever done.
Probably. So this is Skelly Hink, aka I've never worked harder in my life this year. That is a both art imitating life and life imitating art. So this will be the icon. This will change. Should I make it an emote? I guess I should get rid of Zombie Hink and then have Skelly Hink, right? That's what I should do. There will be an exclusive sticker that you can only get if you make a purchase on my shop between October 1st and October 31st, midnight. And there will be less quantity of Skelly Hink than there was of Zombie Hink. So last year I made exactly 50 of Zombie Hinks, and they were numbered. They were hand numbered on the back, and you had to place an order on my website for anything, any item, any product, any dollar amount, but you had to place an order. I gave you a exclusive free Zombie Hink sticker. This year I will do the same, but there will be half. There will be 25 Skelly Hinks. All right, why would you do that, Kevin? Let's just say I had a lot of leftover Zombie Hinks last year. So, but 25. I feel more confident that I'll actually get rid of 25. Funny Fix says, man, I wonder where my Zombie Hink ran out. You can't lose that, man. That is the beginning of a series. They are gone, right? Like, what I had left is, like, I got rid of it because there was no point in having hand-numbered things that I couldn't use. But you can't lose that. That is the beginning of a series. One day, you're going to look back and go, man, I have all whatever. I have all 10. Everything's gotten lost in the move. I'm sure I have it, but we're, yeah, I know how that goes, right? So, Skelly Hink Limited 25. That'll be available on my shop. And then also, I will be updating because hashtag branding. I will be this guy down here, right? Whoop. I will be updating him with this. I like that you have decided your career will end in 10 years. I don't know. I don't know when it'll end. It'll end at some point. I'm trying to think of what's an arbitrary number that it'll be cool to, like, look back and go, wow, I have all these, right? Like, what's the number in which it's like, oh, that's cool, but I've got, like, all whatever, all 6 of these, or all 8 of these, or all 10 of these. I don't know. But my evil plan is to make people feel guilty for missing it. Like I said, I had a lot of leftover Zombie Hinks last year. I'm like, you guys all missed out on this train. And this is going to happen every year from now on. And you're going to regret that you didn't get the first one. So, yes. That'll be the updated branding for Halloween. Skelly Hink will be here with us through the entire month of October. And I will be doing Inktober again this year. This will be my fourth time to do it. And I'm not going to be live streaming them on Instagram. So this will be the first year that I'm not doing that. I don't know what I want to do. I'm definitely going to live stream them somewhere. Maybe here on Twitch. Maybe. Just because I've got the new machine. It's not as like cumbersome to set everything up and everything now. So I might do it here, but it's like...
No matter how anybody says it is, feels good to have made something.
It does. It does feel good to have made something. So maybe I do it here, but it's not going to be on Instagram. So it will be live streamed. I'll obviously post the artwork every day on social media. I'll be asking patrons for suggestions as well. I need to get that post up very soon because I know patrons need time. They need time to do it. Ray says, love it. Do it here. Good riddance to Insta. Good riddance. Yeah. I probably just do it here, right? Probably. Because why would I not? Why would I not? But yeah, they're not as long, right? It's like an hour? I think last year, every live stream was like an hour and maybe some change. So we'll see. But it will be live. It will happen every day. Through the month. Remember that I do travel, I do shows, so there are like a handful of, maybe not, like there's two or three at least, Halloween shows that I'm doing, so there'll be some days where I'll either not be able to do it at all, or it'll be like at a really awkward time. But if that happens, I will of course make up for it afterwards, which is what I've done every year. Every time that's happened, which I'm pretty good about it, but when it happens, I usually will make up for it the very next day with like two of them, so... but yeah, if you're a patron, start thinking, because I'm going to ask you, hey, what do you want me to draw for Inktober? I'm also going to prepare my own list of prompts to do, just because I've noticed the participation of the patron crowd has been waning pretty heavily over the last year. Don't get me wrong, I'm very, very thankful for the people that support me on Patreon, and I know from surveys that I have run that patrons... really enjoy opportunities to directly impact things I'm doing. So like when I say, hey, give me prompts or give me ideas or give, like, they love that. That is like the highest ranking reward on my survey data that they like.
You're making us a little bit uncomfortable.
Relax, big guy. He's just doing this for his art.
I'm just doing this for my art, Ray. So it's really odd to me that, like, according to the data, that is what they like the most, but also their participation in those opportunities is, like, not that great. So, last year, when I asked for prompts for Inktober, I think I ended up giving a few people, like, two or three suggestions because I just didn't get enough prompts. So, I will be making my own list of prompts. That way, I am ready when and if there is not a good response. So I will make sure anybody that participates and anybody that gives me one, it will get drawn. But if there's a lack of participation, I will substitute my own prompts as opposed to asking the few people that are participating to give me 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But, you know, I'm not going to do that. So, yeah. Inner joke here. What's up? Is this that guy redrawing all the Earth? This is that guy. We're going to talk about that in just a second. So, I think that's all I've got for Halloween. So, I showed you guys the stickers that are coming out. I showed you the new icons that are going to be taking over social. I talked about the sticker. I talked about Inktober. I think that's it, right? I think that's all this stuff. So, now, we've talked about... we talked about Fan Expo Boston. We talked about all... I showed all the artwork I drew at that event. We talked about Halloween, all the Halloween plans. So the only thing left to talk about is Earthbound. Ray's like, wait, he's that guy? So guys, I did a thing. I did a thing, guys. I did a thing. K, Kevin, you never told me you liked Earth. That's the biggest, that is the biggest lie Ray has ever said. So, my favorite video game of all time is Earthbound / Mother 2 on the Super Nintendo. I think it's ridiculous, and I love everything about it because of how ridiculous it is. I have played through this game at least 15 times all the way through. Every time it comes back out in some way, shape, or form, I buy it again. So I have the SNES cartridge. I've got it on the Nintendo 3DS. I've got it on the Mini Classic. I got it on the Wii U. I got it on the, like, every, if it comes out again, I buy it every time. I don't have an explanation. I just like it. So I was thinking the other day, man, it would be really cool to somehow figure out this TikTok thing. I've been trying to figure it out. Now, don't get me wrong, I haven't been pulling my hair out, desperately trying to get this to work. But you guys know I'm very busy. I have a lot of other things going on, and I've been struggling with TikTok because it doesn't do well with simply repurposing content I've already made for other platforms. It does not do well. So even with stuff that you think would do well, right? So like when we do the doodle stream every Friday, I make a time lapse from that. And I specifically make a version of it designed with TikTok in mind, right? It is portrait mode. It is the right ratio. It is 45 seconds long because that's all you can get out of somebody for attention span. And that stuff doesn't do super well on TikTok. It like doesn't resonate. It just doesn't, it doesn't click. It doesn't do anything. It certainly does not like it when I just give it still images. TikTok hates that. TikTok hates it when I just say, hey, look, here's this awesome piece of artwork I spent 25 hours on. TikTok hates it. It's not a video. It's not a video. It's not trendy. It's not cool. They don't like it. It doesn't gain any traction. It doesn't get attention. Which, that's not what this is all about. This is not all about likes and stuff. This is about me trying to survive being an artist. So paying my bills, growing my brand as an artist. And yes, does that translate to more follows and more eyes on my work? It has to. It absolutely has to. It has to translate to more eyes on the work, which could turn into more sales on the shop, which could turn into more commissions. So yeah, it is a little bit about that because it has to be. So I've been trying. You need a My Brand? Maybe I do. From that commercial, right? My Brand. I'm going to write that down, right? Hold on. You guys just wait a second. Can you just wait a second, though? My Brand. You know what I still need to do, too? I need to do a Be Right Back screen. I still haven't done that. I need to do that. So I guess that just means I can never leave. During a stream, I have to sit here and not move. So, yeah, I've been frustrated.
Hi, Kevin.
What's up? What's up, Shy Guy? Newest patron. Welcome to the stream. We're talking about Earthbound. We're talking about TikTok and Earthbound is what we're talking about. So, I have been studying what other artists post on TikTok and taking notes, trying to be just really cognizant of what's working, right? And there's a couple of these series that I've been following along, such as redrawing every Pokemon from the first game. So I've been watching an artist who's been doing that, and I've really enjoyed it. And there's a lot of traction for these like series of videos where you're like day one of, day two of, day three, like there's a huge traction for that. So I decided, what the heck, let me try this, but I'm not trying to add a huge task onto my plate, right? That's not what I'm trying to do. Shy Guy says, oh yeah, TikTok is very intricate, to say the very least. Exactly. It's been my least effective platform to date in terms of sharing my work and stuff. So I've been taking notes and stuff, trying to figure this out. I said, you know, what the heck? Let me try to create something specifically for TikTok based on what I see working on TikTok. And I was like, I'll do one of these, like, draw a thing a day. And Earthbound's my favorite game. I'm like, if I'm going to do this, and if I'm going to get through this, I need a subject matter that I am super hyped for. So I picked Earthbound. And so I drew, or I'm planning to draw, every enemy from this game in my own style. This is the runaway dog. This is the first enemy that you come across in this game. The moment you step foot outside your house, he attacks you. It really is him. I'm a huge... Hey. Hey now. I appreciate it. I'm happy it's like working. You cannot believe my joy in that this is working. So, surprise, surprise, I posted this video up. And I did, like I said, I tried to edit it in a kind of a nice, clever way. I wanted it to feel like you were playing the game. So I went and made sure to get the music from the game, the sprite from the, you know, I made the background match. Like I have a, I look up a let's play of an enemy fighting or a player fighting these enemies so I can see what background did they use, what music did they use, and what is the terminology. You know, like, does it say you engage so and so, or does it say something else? Like, so like this, when you play the game, it says you engage the runaway dog. That is the opening text, versus Starman Jr., which was today's video, where it says Starman Jr. blocked the way. So like, I want to use the right terminology. I'm making note of how many experience points you get when you beat it. Like, I want this to be about art and about Earthbound, but also, like, I don't want to time-lapse myself drawing. I don't want to record myself drawing these. See, that's the difference, I think, for me with this and turning it into more of a more work than, like, experimentation and, like, play. Is if I have to start time-lapsing it and then working with that and editing that and getting that. Like, I just don't want to do it. I already do time-lapses. I do time-lapses all the time. I do time-lapses every week with the stream. And it's funny because the videos, we're 4 days in, and the videos have been exceptionally well-received and overwhelmingly positive comments, and I've had a lot of fun engaging with other fans of this. And of course, there's a couple naysayers, right? Because there has to be. And so, of course, you know, one person's like, you should do the time-lapse video so we can see that you actually drew this. And it's like, bruh, you can watch one of the 85 time-lapse videos on my YouTube channel. Or actually, how about this? Just scroll down on my and look at all of the time-lapse videos I've already posted here. And I was like, I don't want to time-lapse these because it's just another thing that I have to, and I don't want to do that. I have more fun editing, like, the music and stuff at the beginning. And, of course, I have all this stuff templated out, right? It's copy-paste, plug-and-play, to keep it low effort. Except for the drawing itself. So here's the other beauty of this. You guys know this is what I do full-time. This is my full-time job. I am an artist full-time. I draw every day, all day. And I draw a lot of cool stuff for a lot of cool people. I draw a lot of awesome stuff. But even then, you can kind of get a little burnt. Like, not like burnout, but you get a little burnt out, like a little tired. And you just want to draw something totally for fun, right? Something for you, for fun. And I don't do a lot of that. I honestly don't do a lot of just purely drawing for fun for me. And so I've been doing this at night, like late at night. Admittedly, late at night. So like after the day is done, right? I'm like, oh, let's draw another couple characters from Earthbound. Guys, I drew like 15 yesterday. I have so much fun doing it. And I've already, like, I'm warmed up for the day, right? Because I've been drawing all day. I've been drawing all day doing other stuff, right? Other work, other projects. And then by the time we get to the end of the day, I'm like, oh, like, I'm ready to cool down and draw some, like, Earthbound. Yeah, it was like 15. I drew so many last night because it was just fun. And I started at like 11, and then I stopped at like 3 in the morning And I was like, I should probably go to bed. Content and fun? You shut your mouth. Ray, that was your cue for the oh Jesus. I'll wait. You shut your mouth.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, God. Oh, oh, Jesus, God. Oh, Mary, Mother of Jesus, Jesus of Nazareth.
There you go. Your redeems have bankrupt. Oh, do you have, you don't have any more, how much exposure money you got, Ray? You're now penniless. $72? That's not a lot of exposure money. You need to be doing more art so you can get more exposure, Ray. So, I'm going to show you some of these. Now, I've only been posting these on TikTok, right? So if you're not on TikTok, well, no, you're out. You got to do more art, Ray. You need to do more art to get more exposure money. You could also watch me. But you already watch me all the time, Ray. So I don't know what else you can do. If you're not on TikTok, you're not seeing these. Now, here's my plan. Here's my plan. You guys can tell me if this plan's stupid or if you think it's sound. My plan is once I get to a week, right? Once I get to a full week, we are on day four today. Today is day four. When I get to a full week, seven full days in, I'm thinking of putting either just the artwork or posting the, like, the, you know, you get a copy of the TikTok. It's, like, saved automatically to your phone once you post it. So you get, like, a version of it with, like, the watermark on it and stuff. Either posting that video or just the artwork to other social platforms. So Twitter, Instagram. This, again, this is very much TikTok first is what this is. My first time really doing that with any of my content. But yeah, I'm thinking like a weekend, right? You get like a week, which in TikTok time is like a lifetime. I already got comments that my 23-second video was too long. I was like, it is 23 seconds. And they're like, it's too long, bro. Bruh, this is too long. Speed it up. Like I said, most of the comments, overwhelmingly positive, very supportive. There is some funny naysayers in there. But yeah, I feel like a week, I guess exclusivity, if you will, is good. Because I mean, I don't know. I feel like you think it's too long, Brian, it's 23 seconds. It's 23. Joke, you want it to be 3 seconds. You want it to be done in an instant. The gimmick of it, here's the gimmick, is that you get to like take, like, we're talking seconds, people. We are talking seconds. You get seconds to see the old artwork and you're like, okay, I got it. Absorbed. And then you see the new artwork and you get a couple seconds to see it, absorbed. And then also the beginning. See, this is now when we go more to the Earthbound fans. The beginning sets the tone because it's different music depending on what area you're about to see this enemy, right? So it's like either, you know, music from one place or the other, whatever. Brian says, it's about what you focus on and for how long. Ray says, is this how one begins hating the new generation? Quicker. Did I just get a great hit? You might have. But I will say, I am not too almighty to be like, this is the way it's going to be. I'm happy to adjust because we've got lots of days ahead of ourselves. We've got like 100-something days ahead of ourselves with all these characters. So I can adjust. But I feel like, I want cool and collected criticisms. Like, for me, I don't know. I'm still struggling with it too long. I don't think it's too... It is 23 seconds long. I don't think it's too long. Could there maybe be, like, one or two seconds trimmed, maybe. Well, I don't know. Like I said, I'm not against it, but I'm going to need... Okay, how about this? This is what I'll say. This is what I'm going to say. I'm not against it, but until I have evidence that shows that a 23-second video, which I did do, that got 27,000 views, was too long, because the data says it's not. The data says it's not, because it's got 27,000 views. So the data says it's not too long. But we shall see. Inner joke here says, okay, I think I figured it out. Maybe instead of speeding it up, just take 3 seconds to draw it. Okay, that's a great plan. Let me show you the, look, now we're done looking at this crow. Look at the new, this is the artwork for the crow. You'll see that these are sketchy. These are sketchy. These are not meant to be polished because, again, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. I want this to be like a fun decompress thing at the end of the day. Brian says, the opening card needs to be half the length while the voiceover continues as your transition to the... Oh, okay, I can play around with that. So obviously I'm also doing like batches, right? Like I'm doing batches of videos. So I'll do like, all right, I'll make like 5. And then I'm like, all right, I'm good for the week. And then I'll put them up each day. Brian says, you don't need the based on there. See, now that's interesting, because also I had one comment, and again, this is one out of like, I'm talking 100+ comments. Sorry, we're talking a fraction of the people enjoying the content. One person was like, you don't need the voiceover. Now, what's interesting is the other artists that I've been following and watching and taking notes from, they all do that. Everybody does that. Like, literally everyone does that. And not just the artists, right? Like, people that go, like, day one of trying to tell my boyfriend, blah, 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 blah. They all have the voiceover. All of them do. There is not a one I've come across that does not have the voiceover. Not one. So I don't know whether or not it should get removed. I kind of like it. I think it makes it more campy and more weird, which is the whole point of the game. That's the whole point of it. It's like weird. Show, don't tell. I mean, I do show. Voiceover is good. You got to trim the fat. Okay, I'll play around with it. Like I said, I'm not totally against it. You're serving a latte and you need it to be an espresso shot. We can play around. So, but lest us not forget it has been successful. And I am very, very, I am overwhelmingly happy that something has been successful on TikTok, the platform that has given me the biggest grief and the most struggle. It has finally started to work. Let me show you some more. Here's the coil snake. That's the old coil snake. Now we need to see the new coil snake. And before we end, I'm going to show you guys all those characters I drew last night. Before we end. So today was the Starman Jr., the star of the show. Starman Jr. What transition effect did you use in Premiere for the square thing? It was a radial swipe. I think that's what it's called. I think it's radial swipe is what it's called. Ray says, how many enemies are on Earth? A million? No, I don't know how many. I think there's like 100 something. And I do want to do the color variants because I want to draw them in a different pose. So like most of the enemies have a nether version in a different color, but like that's it. Like most enemies don't have 2, 3, 4, like it's 2 versions of every enemy. And I am currently am planning to redraw the colored variant, but doing like a slightly different pose. All right, so those are the videos that have been shown. Oh, did I show you that? I didn't show you the new one. I just showed you the old one. Starman Jr. Starman Jr. blocks the way. I'm gonna close out the old ones here. Oops, so we've got Runaway Dog, The Spiteful Crow, The Coil Snake, and Starman Jr. Now, let me take a look. You may hear music here for a second. Pardon me, I'm gonna open up TikTok. When I started this, when I posted the first one 4 days ago, I had approximately 200 follows. Right now I have 1,264. The first video, the Runaway Dog, 27,800 views. 4,213 likes, 93 comments, 319 shares. For this guy, for this pup, for the pupper, for this pupper. Second one, 5,019. The third one, the snake, arguably the least interesting. 1,222. Starman Jr. that I posted today, a couple hours ago. I think exactly 2 hours ago. Maybe two and a half. 2,000 views. I think obviously it helps that it's an obscure video game that's got a ravenous cult following, right? I think that needs to be addressed. It is a ravenous, passionate community. I am, of course, among them for this video game. That helps. But I'm pretty happy. I'm pretty happy, guys. So, yeah, 2,002 hours. Yes. Isn't that insane? It's just crazy. All right. Do you guys want to go into the future and see some Earthbound enemies that have not been shared yet? I must wait for verbal confirmation. Oh, also, hey, my Kickstarter campaign ends in a couple days. Don't forget. Leaked art? Yes.
Oh, no.
It's leaked. You're going to get to see super secret. Don't look. Here's where I would play the oh yeah sound. All right. So, I'm showing you secrets. After, so in the game, if you know you're Earthbound. Inner Joke says unrelated, but do you know what song is playing? This is a 24-hour radio thing. It is currently DJ Cutman. Oh, what does that say? Something Grooves? Take in the Scenery. Fantasy Grooves. It's something video game related, but I don't know what video game. A little more than exposing why. Yeah, it's because I was working on it. So, in the game, after you beat Starman Jr., which is today. Today's Starman Jr., day 4. Ness goes to the town. He goes to Onet. And then he goes to the arcade. And that's where the next enemies come in to play, is the Onet arcade. So we've got the Shark Gang. So this is the Yes Man Jr. That is his official name, Yes Man Jr. And he has a hula hoop. And what I always found fascinating about this character, and then the next one I'm gonna show you guys on the pogo stick, is that they don't have eyes. Like, they're wearing this, like, outfit, or, like, this mask. on their face. And they've got goggles, but there's no eyes. It's like they just put it on over the mask. And it's like, I found that fascinating as a kid. I still find it fascinating. And so it's like, I kind of implied a little bit that there's eyes using just the lighter tone of the mask, but there's no eyes. Races, I think what excites me the most about all of this is the obvious next step in 100 odd days is you'll need to play Mother 3 to do that. I mean, obviously, I did get a couple comments that people want Mother 1 and Mother 3, and I have been very honest with them saying, I have not played either of those, just for the record. And I'm deeply ashamed of myself. All right, so here's the Yes Man Jr., all right? Next, after we fight the Yes Man Jr., we fight the Pogo Punk. So this is the Pogo Punk, another member of the Sharks gang. And the Pogo Stick. It's a fun angle because it's definitely like looking down. That's how it looks in the sprite. That's how it looks in the artwork. And the Pogo is definitely spiked at the end. Which I don't know how long you'd be able to pogo on that, right? You damage that sucker up pretty quick. But it's got like little sparks shooting off. And yeah, love the sound effect. No notes. So yeah, Pogo Punk. That is the Pogo Punk. What's interesting about his sprite is he's definitely wearing like a striped slash like a knitted sweater. See, that's what I... So, like, I know the official art, right? And I've got the player's guide. I've definitely spent times of my life looking at the Earthbound artwork over and over and over again. So, like, I know what these things are supposed to be versus what they look like in the sprite. But that's another fun part of this challenge, is like, no, I'm gonna do it based on the sprite. I just look at the sprite when I draw it. I don't look at anything else, but sometimes I can remember, you know, muscle memory of what these things look like. And I'm like, it's hard for me to like push that out of my head. Like, no, do this based on the sprite. So like some of these, like I think the Yes Man Jr., this guy's like, the official art is like his outfit is black. It's like all black with like the skeleton. But I'm like, dude, this is purple. This sprite is 1000% purple. But like the official artwork is black. And so it's like, it's, yeah, we're doing this based on the sprites. So his sprite definitely in my mind made it look like he's wearing like a green knitted sweater. So there's the Pogo Punk. And now there's one more. There's one more of Shark gang member. We've got the Skate Punk. We've got the Skate Punk. I re-edited it. Oh, did you? Nice. What does that mean? Did you send it to me somewhere? Did you duet it? I don't even know what any of this means. I don't know what... I'm the oldest man on TikTok. No, there's probably older. But that's cool. No, I look forward to seeing it. So this amazing race is amazing. This is the Skate Punk. So again, he is another member of the Shark Gang. He's not wearing the full suit like these guys are. He has got suspenders and big old goggles, and he's got a helmet with a shark fin on it. They all have shark fins, which is a symbol of the Shark Gang. And his skateboard is definitely metal. The sprite is shooting off some sparks on the bottom. And he's got like bolts. So this guy is nice. What is this? YouTube. Okay, let me. I'm gonna bring it open just to have it open, but I just wanna have it open so I can then pause it. I'll keep that up and pause, so I've got it ready. Thank you. Thank you, good sir, for your expert editing. I'll take a look at that. What was I saying about this guy? So yeah, there he is. That's the Skate Punk. Okay. Now, are we ready for the leader of the shark gang? I hope you guys are enjoying it. I can't tell you how happy this stuff makes me. Okay, it's been a long year. I've drawn a lot of stuff for everyone else but me, okay? I've drawn a couple things for me, but a lot for other people. All right, we're getting Frank. Come down here, Frank. Hold on, let me rearrange some guys. Don't worry, I'll show you all of them in due time. Here is Frank. Don't look at the tent. Here's Frank, the leader of the sharks. Oh, Lord. So this is the leader of the shark gang in his snazzy outfit. Now, he is super ugly. Oh, watching that video aged. Oh, did you watch it, Ray? It aged you 10 more years. What's okay, so again, talking about official art versus sprite art. The official art for Frank. Here, let me just draw on this. So the official artwork for Frank always has him with this big grin. He's always got this big grin, always. On all the official artwork. In the sprite, no, sir. That is not how he looks like in the sprite. In the sprite, he's got this super ugly smile, and it's like all crooked. It's like doing, I mean, like how I kind of drew it. It's like going off to the side, and it's mostly red. Like most of it is red. It's kind of disturbing. Most of it is red, except he's got two teeth. Like that. And I'm like, oh, what? That. So that's why I gave him this insane mouth expression. Let me undo this. Because I'm like, the dude's got two teeth. And he's like clearly wearing lipstick, or he's got very, very red lips. And because it's just all red, like his whole mouth is red except for those two jutting teeth marks. So but yeah, his official artwork, again, like I had to force my mind to forget that, is he's got this big grin on everything. And I'm like, no, that's not what he looks like in the sprite, though. That is not what he looks like in the sprite. He's also got this, like, this necklace. And again, in the official artwork, it's really weird. It's like a knife. It's like this. It's like a knife. But like almost like a chili pepper. It's like a chili pepper knife. But it doesn't look like that at all in the sprite. It looks like a guitar pick in the sprite. So that's how I drew it like that. And he's definitely rocking the mullet and the shark fin hair. So after Frank is Frank's machine. He's got like this wooden robotic. I have not drawn that yet. Okay? That has not happened. So now this is where I just started bouncing around and just drawing stuff that I wanted to draw. Right? I was like, what characters do I want to draw? So we've got this one's coming up pretty soon. This is the slug. So you go to like the cave. So after you beat Frank and Frank's machine and the arcade as a whole, you go to the first sanctuary location, which is a cave in the top part of Own It, where you go to your first, you face your first sanctuary guardian and get your first melody of the Soundstone. So you're in a cave, so you see these slugs. Another fun detail. See, this is the stuff you get here from watching this versus watching on TikTok, because you get no commentary. You get no expert artist commentary on this. So for this one, the sprite absolutely has like a horse slash zebra like mane. Absolutely. You can't tell me it doesn't. Like, the sprite 100% has this thing going on. 100% has that thing going on. But the official artwork, it's just like a slug. Like, it's just like the top of the rest of it. But when you look at the sprite, I'm like, that thing's got like a horse mane. Yep. Got a horse mane. So that's how he's drawn like that. I think this is the attack slug. Why are the sound effects not part of the TikToks? Alongside that makes me feel dead inside narration. Alright, slug. Starman was posted today. He's old news now. He's already old news. I gotta be super cropped in so you guys don't see everything right out. That's not fun. That's not fun. Okay. Alright, who do we got next? Who do we got next? Oh, we got the ant! This is the... If memory serves me correctly, this is the black antoid. This guy... I love this guy. Look at this guy. He is having a ball. Don't you like that guy? Look how adorable he is, an ant. Now, with this one, I decided to go a little bit more like real ant. So that's why I kind of gave him like the plating and stuff. And, you know, as a kid, I'm like, that's the eyes. 100% that's the eyes as a child. But I'm like, yeah, but that's not on an ant. That's not the eyes. So I used my adult brain and I add the eyes. So that's the, I'm pretty sure that's the black antoid. So also in the cave. All right, antoid. Come on down. All right, who's next? Who do we got next? We got, oh man. Wait, no, we're not ready for that one yet. We get the rowdy mouse. Here's the rowdy mouse. He's like a sickly green. This guy definitely comes back in the game. I think this is maybe one of the few characters that gets like three recolors. But I really didn't change him that much from the sprite, because it's like pretty good. You know? So I didn't do too much. I just like kind of drew it in my style. So yeah, Rowdy Mouse. Nothing super crazy there. I think there's like an appropriate time with certain ones to be like, okay, I should push this one a little bit more. All right, next. You're not ready for those guys down there yet. This guy. It's the walking like little tree sprout. This guy's legendary. This is definitely a legendary Earthbound enemy. And this guy comes back again as like a all white version. It's like a dead plant, I think. Or I guess a plant that has had no sunlight. So this one's like a, this was a, I mean, obviously a pretty simple one. See, some of these I can knock. This is why, like I said, like I did 15 last night. Some of them are easy enough that you just knock them out. All right, you guys want to see the Mad Duck? This is, all right, talking about legendary. This guy's legendary. This is a legendary Earthbound enemy.
Oh, Jesus! Oh, God! Oh, oh, Jesus! God! Oh, Mary, Mother of Jesus! Jesus of Nazareth!
Yes. The Mad Duck fell down. This is the Mad Duck. The Mad Duck is a legendary Earthbound enemy because it's ridiculous and it's like useless and it does nothing, and it's in-game text when it dies is like the Mad Duck fell down. That's like the most ludicrous thing ever. So there he is. There's the Mad Duck. He has a massive like chin, like his beak chin is like massive. All right, now we're like, so we're really jumping around the game now. This is Nooseman. Ray, do you remember Nooseman? this is a character in this game. This is a walking noose with cartoon legs and cartoon eyes. Nooseman. I added the little skull and crossbones. I was trying to go for like a cartoony cutesy vibe. I mean, I get it's a noose, but like, you know I don't, but that's amazing. So this character is a very kind of obscure, oh, they're all obscure. This character shows up in very obscure places and not very often. So it's like, I think you fight him when you're inside the giant dungeon man in the desert, and maybe one other time. But it's a walking cartoon noose. That's Noose Man. So there you go. This was one of the comments on the first video was like, I cannot wait for when you draw Noose Man. Somebody said that. So yeah, we're definitely hopping around now in like the game. I was just drawing characters I thought would be fun to draw. All right, here is the flying little UFO with a bow on it. So there's two UFOs in the game, like little tiny ones, little tiny enemies. There's like a male one and a female one. And the this is, I don't remember the exact name. It's like the little UFO or something like that, but it's got a bow. And I don't know if those are eyes. I mean, you could imply that they're eyes on the sprite, but it could also be like windows. Because it's like a, you know, UFO with little circular windows. So I'm like, eh, I think I'm going to go with super cartoony eyes. So that's the little UFO. You do remember this. This one's kind of early on. This is like when you're going through the, you're going to Saturn Valley, I believe. So you're going through like the wilderness behind Tucson and you come across that. Guys, everybody listen up. It's the worthless protoplasm. Everybody look at this. Please look at this. This. This character is amazing. And I need you to understand. This looks almost exactly like the sprite. I understand what it looks like. I am fully aware of what it looks like. And so does it. That's why it's so sad. And its name is the Worthless Protoplasm. That is the name of this character. The Worthless Protoplasm. All right, we've got, this is a fan favorite. There was a few folks that made comments saying, I want to see how you draw Foppy. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Foppy. 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 It's beautiful. Isn't it beautiful? Foppy. So, in the game... Oh, it's so funny. In the game, these things are, like, they're pretty good experience droppers, right? So you do a lot of, like, grinding and destroying foppies a lot. And they're notorious for calling in help. So, for those of you guys that didn't know this, all of the alerts on this channel are from Earthbound. That sound is from Earthbound when someone follows. That's from Earthbound. That's also from Earthbound. Every sound I use is from Earthbound. When somebody hosts, That's the sound an enemy makes when it calls in help to fight. Foppy is the king of calling in help. Foppies are notorious. Sometimes a foppy battle will take you forever because there's like seven foppies and you're like, you're taking them out as fast as you can, and there's always one left and it calls in help. And so like one or seven turns into like 35 foppies. And it's like, why won't they go away? you just keep annihilating them over and over and over. So that's Foppy. Foppy has already been requested by the people. So Foppy is gonna happen. All right, what else we got? Oh, this, look at this one. This seems like this is up Ray's alley. So this is an interesting character that I don't necessarily know if people are going to be expecting this one. But I'm counting it. Because this is not necessarily an enemy you fight, but you do get into the battle screen with this guy. So this is Pooh, name of one of the characters. He's a prince. This is Pooh's ancestor. And he goes to train. So part of the game is you take over Pooh as a solo character for a time, and you have to go to a mountaintop and do some mental training. And you go into a battle with this character. You don't fight this character, but you go into the battle screen. It has the battle menu. It has all the same stuff. And all this character does is defeat you. He breaks your legs. He breaks your arms. He rips out your eyes. He rips your ears. Like, these are real things. He rips off your ears, your eyes, and you black out. And you're meant to lose. It is not a real battle. You don't really fight. I don't think, if I recall, you ever even select anything. You just, like, read the prompts and just go along with it. And then that's how you win. Like, you survive and you grow because you were able to withstand the greatest torture of all time. So I don't know if people will be expecting this one, but this is Pooh's ancient ancestor. So yeah, he is like a disembodied head that kind of looks like an older version of him that you fight with a little ghostly tail. Ray likes it. Now there's another enemy in the same area of the game, which is very similar, and it's an enemy you fight. It's also like kind of an old, like Asian master kind of looking guy, but he doesn't have like the ponytail, and he has a little bit bushier mustache. Other than that, he's very similar to the other one, but he's definitely a bad guy, and you definitely fight him, and he's all red with evil energy. So I did that one because I had already drawn a disembodied floating head, so I figured I'd draw another floating disembodied head. And I gave him a little bit more substance, even though technically he should be more see-through like this guy is, but it was hard to see the red, so I added a little bit of white and pink and purple mist. Do I have any more that are completed? I think I do. At least two more. So we've got this little guy. Look at how adorable this guy is. Brian, I drew this last night. I was drawing this while you were live with Jang Bricks. This was on the tablet. This is the Sentry Robot, if I recall. This is much later in the game. This is like when you are in Foreside. This little robot is blocking the way, and you actually can't beat him. So the Runaway Five run in, and they switch him off. Like, in the middle of the battle, they just run in, and they say, oh, look, there's a switch on the back of it, and they turn it off, and you win the fight. So there's no way to win it, but it's a battle that occurs. So that's, like, I think his name is Sentry Robot. So he's a little guy. This next one was the last one I did last night before I went to bed. Ladies and gentlemen, the boogie tent. The boogie tent, ladies and gentlemen. Take a moment. Take it all in. Make this a stick. Nobody's gonna buy that, Ray. As much as I would love to base everything I do from now on only on Earthbound art, I don't think anyone would buy that. This is a disembodied face It's not even a head, it's a face. This is from Threed. When you go fight the zombies and there is a circus tent, a full-scale, full-size circus tent. Like, think about the sprite of a character, like, full-size. And it's possessed, it's not real. It's this, it's a creature. And so the face emerges from the side of the tent, and then you go into the fight. The fight is just the face. So it's a floating face on the background. It doesn't even have the background of the tent from the game. It's just the regular, like, enemy flashing patterns background, but it's a face. So this is the boogie tent. I was really trying to play with, like, the steam and stuff coming out of his mouth, because it's like his mouth, even in the sprite, is definitely like a vortex, right? Like, so that is a gateway in his mouth. So that's the boogie tent. This one's gonna come back again too, because there is another recolor of the boogie tent later in the game. But I mean, how many expressions can I guess? I would like to do them differently for the recolors, so I'll have to figure out what I want to do for. I mean, he's just a face. All right, those are the ones I've finished. I can show you guys the sketches for some of the other ones. This guy's gonna be great. This guy is gonna be awesome. This is like the, I think it's called Heavily Armored Frog or Heavily Armored Toad. Now this one I think is gonna be one of the best examples of the sprite artwork being drastically different than the real artwork. The real artwork is this toad, and he's just like a frog, but he's got like this gold-plated stomach, right? So he's upright, he's more of a cartoony frog, but he's a frog, and he's got like this gold-plated stomach. And that's really it. Now, as a kid, as a child, I'm like, why is that frog sitting in a pineapple? Forever, to this day, I look at that sprite and I go, it looks like a frog wearing a cut pineapple. That's what it looks like. It doesn't look like armor. The real artwork, it's armor. I've seen the frog. I get it. But the sprite, it looks like he's wearing a pineapple. So I am drawing him wearing a pineapple. So the toad is going to be in a sliced and cut, hollowed out pineapple. And I'm going to add a little flag. The little, like, or not a flag, a little umbrella. I wrote flag. It was late last night. A little umbrella sticking out of the back, so that way, you know, because in the sprite that's not there, but like it's also more head-on, so I'm drawing him at an angle like, oh, maybe there could be a little umbrella back there that we're not seeing because we're not looking at it head-on. So that's going to be really fun to do, and that's going to be a really good departure from like the sprite and the official work. I started working on Frank's robot. So he's like made out of barrels and like a tank. I was kind of struggling with his head. He's got like, it almost looks like an egg beater out of the top of his head. But also you can make the case that it's just like wires that are kind of balled up. So I need to figure out what I want to do with that. He's got a little flag. He's got a little exhaust pipe. And the body is definitely wood planks. So I need to work on that. Here's a little cloud with some lightning. That's from Dalam. And then I don't know if I'm gonna stick with the cartoon. I kind of want to just do like a poof, like use like a watercolor brush and just do a poof. This guy is from super late in the game. He is like a businessman who's on fire. So he's got like a little suit and a tie. He's got this really interesting, like, metal cap that is on the top of his head with little bolts, and he's definitely melting. Like, you can see his face on the sprite, it's got like some weird veins and stuff going on, but the rest of him is on fire. He's literally on fire. He's a fire businessman. I need to replay Earthbound. Yeah, you do, Ray. And then what else do I got? I don't have much left. We've got the ghost. They have these really weird, wispy ghosts in Earthbound. Like, they look, they're like really odd. Like, they have really long limbs, and their tail is really long. It's like very unsettling. So I'm trying to get that in this with this ghost. I'm not like super sold on the eyes. I don't mind the mouth because they do have like these weird big buck teeth, but that is the ghost. These things, you encounter them in the tunnels. They try to block you from going to the next town until you beat all the ghosts from three, and then they vanish. And then in the when you get to the Foreside department store, there's this cup of coffee that has like a splash coming out of it, and the splash, I feel like, is implied to be a giant hand, but it's not quite there. Like, you could just trim in a couple spots and you would see a hand, but the sprite is like, it's a splash, kind of like a, I'm just making it a hand. I'm like, this is absolutely a hand made out of coffee is what it is. So I'm just like, I'm completing its evolution for it. So that's it, guys. That's what I got right now. So as you can see, I've got plenty of... Oops. I've got plenty of stuff already done. And I have a lot of fun doing it, if you can't tell from just me talking about it. I have a lot of fun doing it. It's not draining at all. It's very energizing and fun. And I usually do it at the end of the day, when I'm already done doing my other stuff. Yeah, thanks, Ray. And the videos are going to keep going up every day on TikTok until it's done. And I don't think I'm going to have an issue with that because I have so much front-loaded content that I don't think it'll be an issue. But I am going in order. So as you can see, I was going in order for a little bit, and then I just started popping all around the game. So I need to reel it back in and go back to the order so I have content that's actually needed. The mad duck fell down. So that's it. That's been our 2 hours, 2 hours and 17 minutes. I didn't draw like anything, which is fine, because I didn't think I was going to. We had a lot of stuff to talk about today. And I hope you guys enjoy seeing this. Thank you for being here. Remember, let me close these things out here. But yeah, Halloween stickers, they're coming out October 1st. I will have an exclusive Skelly Hink sticker available if you make an order in my shop during the month of October. The Doodle Book wraps up Friday. Exclamation point book. Friday it ends. That's your last chance. If you really want a book and you want to guarantee yourself a book, check out the Kickstarter. I will have extras when this is done, but not a lot. I wouldn't bank on that being the way to get the book. So make sure you follow the check out the Kickstarter. We only have a couple more days left. I think it ends at 6:30 on Friday. So it'll end right when I end the stream. Speaking of which, Friday, I'm going 30 minutes early. All right, so I know I normally go at 5. We're going at 4:30. So we're going to have 2 hours, 4:30 to 6:30, right when the Kickstarter ends at 6:30. We're going to watch it live together. We'll be doodling something. I don't know yet. I haven't, like, we already did all the redeem, the doodle redemption, so I don't have any saved, quote-unquote bad ones, so I don't know. We'll figure it out. Ray says, I will continue not to watch TikTok, but amazing work and well-deserved. Thank you, Ray. Yeah, like I said, I'll probably wait a week in and then start posting the artwork elsewhere, I think. I think that's what I'll do. So, like, the TikTokers, they'll get a week, which, as we've already established, is an eternity for TikTok time, I guess. But they'll get a week advanced notice. And yeah, thank you guys for everything. Thanks for being here, as always. Thanks for chatting with me. Talked about FanExpo Boston, showed you guys the artwork coming from that. And now I will just find another artist to go raid and get out of here. If you've got any last minute questions, please let me know. I'd be happy to listen. Oh man. action Hank Beard is live. Oh, goodness gracious. I have to rate him. He is a massive inspiration to me. He is an incredible artist. I support him on Patreon. I love everything this guy does. And he does not stream super often. Or he hasn't streamed super often lately. So let's take our small little band of art lovers and go say hi to Action Hank Beard. I share his work on social all the time. I just did recently. He did a Pokemon Red and Pikachu. So we're going to raid Action Hank Beard. Yeah, if you can stop by, say hello, drop him a follow. I know he'd appreciate it. He is an incredible person. Yeah. Cool. I'm going to start the raid. Thank you guys again. I will see you Friday at 4:30 for our watch party as we watch the end of the Doodle Book campaign on Kickstarter. Thank you, everybody. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Fuzzy Pickles.